Inclined plane problems can be a little confusing, but I think once you understand them, you will realize that they are just a tilted version of a flat plane problem. So the key is a bit of visualization and correct resolution of force vectors in x and y direction. And this is exactly what we will learn in this lesson. So what you have here is an inclined plane that has block M2 of mass 3.7 kilograms on a frictionless plane that is inclined at an angle of 30 degrees. And this is connected by a cord over a massless frictionless pulley to a second block of mass M1 of 2.3 kilograms. And let us say we have been asked to find the magnitude of the acceleration of each block, the direction of this acceleration, and the tension in the cord. So let us deconstruct this problem and solve it step by step. And I can tell you for sure that once you learn this, you will be able to solve pretty much any problem that has an inclined plane, of course, with some practice. So step one here would be to make a free body diagram. And let us start with M1 and see it in isolation, as if that is the only item in the entire system. And what we can see right away is that force of gravity is acting on M1 vertically down. So let us go ahead and mark it as M1G. And this force of gravity will induce tension in the cord in the upward direction, because we know that the force of tension is always a pulling force, and that is what this force T is doing here as well. It is pulling mass M1 up. Also, you can observe that this tension is what is stopping the free fall of mass M1. Now, let us see what are the forces acting on mass M2. Well, we can see M2G is acting straight down. And you got to remember that Mg as a force always acts vertically down towards the center of the earth. So it'll not be in this direction as some students might think. The other force acting on M2 is tension T in the cord. And since it is one single cord passing smoothly over the pulley, there would be a similar tension in the string on this side as well. And this is a force which will actually pull mass M2 up the incline. Now, do you see any other force acting on M2? No, there is no other force. So let us move on to step two, where we will write the equation F net is equal to ma for both these masses. And let us start with mass M1. But before we do that, let's quickly remember that any vector acting in downward direction would be negative, upward would be positive, to the left would be negative, and to the right would be positive. So keeping this vector notation in mind, the equation for this mass would look like this. Tension T is acting in upward direction, and we take it positive. M1G is acting in downward direction, so we take it as negative. And then this becomes a net force acting on M1. And this net force is what causes acceleration A that we have to find. So now we move to the right hand side, that would be the product of mass and the acceleration. Now, two important things you need to remember, and I would like you to understand this part nicely. One, we do not know the direction of acceleration A as yet. It could be this way or this way. Number two, this A here is the magnitude of A, or the absolute value of A. It tells us nothing about the direction yet. Okay, now let us assume that M1 will go down, or the acceleration is happening in downward direction. And with this assumption, we can put a sign here and write it as minus A. And we will revisit this assumption in a moment. So this is equation one we have written for mass M1. Now let us go ahead and write the equation F net is equal to ma for mass M2. And it would make things a lot easier for us if we take the direction of x-axis in the direction of motion. And so we will need to have a tilted rectangular coordinate system for M2. And let me say that there is nothing wrong with using our usual coordinate system like this, but the expressions for components would be a lot messier because of the misalignment of the x-axis with the motion. So with this as a coordinate system, we can already see that the force of tension is aligned with the x-axis. However, M2G is not, and therefore we will resolve M2G into its components so that those components align with the rectangular coordinates we have chosen and make it easier for us to write the equation F is equal to MA. So if this is angle theta, then simple geometry tells us that this should also be angle theta. And therefore, the component of force M2G in this direction would become M2G cos theta. And in this direction, it will be M2G sin theta. We can also go ahead and mark the normal reaction of the inclined plane to mass M2 in this direction. And again, I would like to remind you that normal reaction is always perpendicular to the surface of contact. So it will not be in this direction or this direction. It has to be perpendicular to this surface. Now, with this done, things get a lot simpler to write the equation F is equal to MA for mass M2. So on the left hand side, we see tension T acting in this direction. So we will take it as positive, and M2G sine theta acting in this direction. So we will take it as negative, and we will equate this with product of M2 and A, which is assumed to be in this direction. And therefore we are taking a plus A. Another observation we can make is that since this block is not moving in the vertical direction, its acceleration must be zero, and the normal reaction and M2G cos theta must be equal and cancelling each other. In fact, we should write the equation F is equal to MA in this direction as well, and that would be N minus M2G cos theta is equal to M2A in vertical direction. But then, since A in vertical direction is zero, the right hand side becomes zero, and what you get is N is equal to M2G cos theta, which we had figured out even before we wrote the equation. Now, between equation 1 and 2, we have two unknowns. So we will go ahead and subtract equation 1 from equation 2, and what we get is M1G minus M2G sin theta is equal to M2A plus M1A. And this gives us A is equal to M1 minus M2 sin theta into G upon M1 plus M2. And when you put in the relevant values for M1, M2, theta and G, you get the answer as 0.735 meters per second square. And now is the time to revisit our assumption of direction of A we made earlier and find if it was correct or not. So we see that since A has turned out to be a positive number, and that is what we had started with, that is, A was a positive number, then we can say that our initial assumption that direction of motion M1 is downwards and M2 is up was correct. And if A had turned out to be a negative number, let us say, our assumption would have been incorrect, and the direction of motion would have been opposite to our assumption. As an example, let us say mass M2 was 5 kilograms instead of 3.7 kilograms. Then calculations for A would have given us a value of minus 0.27 meters per second square, or a negative number. And that would have told us that our assumption that M1 will go down would have been incorrect, and actually M1 would have gone up and M2 would have slid down like this. Okay, now we know the acceleration, so we can find the value of T as T is equal to M2A plus M2G sine theta. And again, when you put in the value of M2A and theta, what you get is 20.8 newtons. So here is a playlist that will give you deep insights and ideas around how to crack problems around Newton's laws of motion. Do check it out, and also please leave a comment if you like the lesson. That would be great help, and I'll see you in the next lesson.